Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Economic Weapon, The Rise of Sanctions as a Tool of Modern War, by Nicholas Mulder. Narrated by Liam Gerrard. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Napoleon, in a conversation which he once had with Goethe on the nature of tragedy, expressed the opinion that its modern phase differed from the ancient, through our no longer recognising a destiny to which men are absolutely subject, and that policy occupies the place of the ancient fate, la politique et la fatalité. This, therefore, he thought, must be used as the modern form of destiny in tragedy, the irresistible power of circumstances to which individuality must bend. G. W. F. Hegel. Lectures on the Philosophy of History. Introduction. Something more tremendous than war. Can war be banished from the earth? Throughout modern history, world peace has been a powerful ideal. It has also been one of the most elusive. Each major war produced its share of cynics as well as visionaries. Pessimists saw war as an inescapable part of the human condition. Optimists viewed growing wealth, expanding self-government, and advancing technology as drivers of slow but steady moral progress. This veering between hope and desolation took on a new urgency after the unprecedented destruction of World War I. The victors created a new international organisation, the League of Nations, which promised to unite the world's states and resolve disputes through negotiation. The collapse of the global political and economic order in the 1930s and the outbreak of a Second World War have made it easy to dismiss the League as a utopian enterprise. Many at the time and since concluded that the peace treaties were fatally flawed and that the new international institution was too weak to preserve stability. Their view, still widespread today, is that the League lacked the means to bring disturbers of peace to heel. But this was not the view of its founders, who believed they had equipped the organisation with a new and powerful kind of coercive instrument for the modern world. That instrument was sanctions, described in 1919 by US President Woodrow Wilson as something more tremendous than war. The threat was an absolute isolation that brings a nation to its senses just as suffocation removes from the individual all inclinations to fight. Apply this economic, peaceful, silent, deadly remedy, and there will be no need for force. It is a terrible remedy. It does not cost a life outside of the nation boycotted, but it brings a pressure upon that nation which, in my judgment, no modern nation could resist. In the first decade of the League's existence, the instrument described by Wilson was often referred to in English as the economic weapon. In French, the Geneva-based organisation's other official language, it was known as l'arme économique. Its designation as a weapon pointed to the wartime practice of blockade that had inspired it. During World War I, the Allied and Associated Powers, led by Britain and France, had launched an unprecedented economic war against the German, Austro-Hungarian, and Ottoman empires. They erected national blockade ministries and international committees to control and interrupt flows of goods, energy, food, and information to their enemies. It was the severe impact on Central Europe and the Middle East, where hundreds of thousands died of hunger and disease, and civilian society was gravely dislocated, that made the blockade seem such a potent weapon. Today, more than a century after the Great War, these measures have a different but more widely known name: economic sanctions. How economic sanctions arose in the three decades after World War I and developed into their modern form is the subject of this book. Their emergence signalled the rise of a distinctively liberal approach to world conflict, one that is very much alive and well today. Sanctions shifted the boundary between war and peace, produced new ways to map and manipulate the fabric of the world economy, changed how liberalism conceived of coercion, and altered the course of international law. They caught on rapidly as an idea propounded by political elites, civic associations, and technical experts in Europe's largest democracies, Britain and France, but also in Weimar Germany, in early fascist Italy, and in the United States. But then, as now, sanctions aroused opposition. From the outbreak of war in 1914 until the creation of the United Nations Organization in 1945, a diverse assortment of internationalists and their equally varied opponents engaged in a high-stakes struggle about whether the world could be made safe for economic sanctions. When the victors of World War I incorporated the economic weapon into Article 16 of the Covenant of the League of Nations, they transformed it from a wartime to a peacetime institution. Like other innovative aspects of the League's work in the realms of global economic governance, world health, and international justice, sanctions outlived the organisation itself and continued as part of the United Nations after World War II. Since the end of the Cold War, their use has surged. Today, they are used with great frequency. In retrospect, the economic weapon reveals itself as one of liberal internationalism's most enduring innovations of the 20th century, and a key to understanding its paradoxical approach to war and peace. Based on archival and published materials in 5 languages across 6 countries, this book provides a history of the origins of this instrument. The original impulse for a system of economic sanctions came at the 1919 Paris Peace Conference from the British delegate Lord Robert Cecil and his French counterpart Léon Bourgeois. These men were unlikely partners. Cecil, an aristocratic barrister and renegade member of the Conservative Party, was a fervent free trader who became Britain's first minister of blockade during the war. Bourgeois, the son of a Republican watchmaker, worked his way up the professions to become a radical party prime minister in the 1890s and advocated a political theory of mutual aid known as solidarisme. But despite these different backgrounds, both Cecil and Bourgeois agreed that the League could, and should, be equipped with a powerful enforcement instrument. They envisioned deploying the same techniques of economic pressure used on the Central Powers against future challenges of the Versailles Order. Such recalcitrant countries would be labelled aggressors, a new, morally loaded legal category, and subjected to economic isolation by the entire League. The methods of economic warfare were thus repurposed and refined for use outside a formally declared state of war. What made interwar sanctions a truly new institution was not that they could isolate states from global trade and finance, it was that this coercive exclusion could take place in peacetime. The significance of the birth of economic sanctions lies in this momentous shift in the meaning of war and peace. A coercive policy that used to be possible only in time of war, isolating human communities from exchange with the wider world, now became possible in a wider range of situations. Commercial and financial blockade, a policy developed as a form of economic war, was reconceived as a prophylactic against war. By carving out the space in which international economic sanctions have been used for the last century, the League thus had a much more profound impact on modern history than is usually assumed. Indeed, this book argues that the struggle to create and use the weapon of sanctions deeply shaped the interwar world and thereby the structure of the political and economic order that we inhabit today. For one thing, it marked the international emergence of a new form of liberalism, one that worked through a technical and administrative apparatus of lawyers, diplomats, military experts, and economists. These officials' work, first in wartime and then after 1919, had far-reaching effects. In a period when European governments granted suffrage and extended welfare and social insurance, sanctions made them see other populations as suitable targets of coercive pressure. Long-standing traditions, such as the protection of neutrality, civilian non-combatants, private property, and food supplies, were eroded or circumscribed. Meanwhile, new practices, such as police action against aggressor states and logistical assistance to the victims of aggression, arose. All of this amounted to a major and complex transformation of the international system. Today, economic sanctions are generally regarded as an alternative to war. But for most people in the interwar period, The economic weapon was the very essence of total war. Many sanctionists regretfully noted the devastating effects of pressure on civilians, but nonetheless wholly accepted them. Woodrow Wilson held that, if thoughtful men have thought and thought truly that war is barbarous, the boycott is an infinitely more terrible instrument of war. William Arnold Forster, a British blockade administrator and ardent internationalist, admitted that during the Great War, we tried, just as the Germans tried, to make our enemies unwilling that their children should be born. We tried to bring about such a state of destitution that those children, if born at all, should be born dead. Internationalists were exceedingly honest about this awful reality for a good reason. By deliberately spelling out the horror of enforced deprivation, they hoped to dissuade revisionist states from even thinking about challenging the Versailles Order. A fear of being blockaded would keep the peace. The initial intention behind creating the economic weapon was thus not to use it. To interwar internationalists, economic sanctions were a form of deterrence, prefiguring nuclear strategy during the Cold War. Of course, sanctions were not nearly as immediately destructive as nuclear weapons, but for anyone living in the pre-nuclear decades of the early 20th century, they raised a frightening prospect. A nation put under comprehensive blockade was on the road to social collapse. The experience of material isolation left its mark on society for decades afterward, as the effects of poor health, hunger, and malnutrition were transmitted to unborn generations. Weakened mothers gave birth to underdeveloped and stunted children. The economic weapon thereby cast a long-lasting socio-economic and biological shadow over targeted societies, not unlike radioactive fallout. Feminist politicians and scholars in particular recognised this during the Great War itself, and many pursued an energetic campaign against the economic weapon's targeting of civilians. The women's movement played an active role in the international history of sanctions, largely opposing and moderating their force, although also sometimes supporting them as preferable to war. The economic weapon was not the only interwar practice to instill fear in civilians. In 1923, future British Prime Minister Ramsay MacDonald warned that the next war will be worse than ever. There will be blockade, and what is more, there will be the air raids, with poisonous gases, which will simply devastate whole towns and whole countrysides. Both airplanes and poison gas were feared for the indiscriminate fashion in which they wounded and killed, but their effect was in the first place psychological. Aerial bombing during World War I killed about 1,400 civilians in Britain and several hundred on the continent, out of a total death toll in the range of 20 million. Air power had the ability to strike terror and was used as a cheap form of colonial control in the 1920s. Only the advent of the four-engine bomber in the late 1930s, however, made strategic bombing possible. Gas also became a highly feared weapon, but during the Great War it was not used on civilians, and on a generous estimate it killed about 90,000, or 7% of the estimated 1.2 million soldiers affected by it. Moreover, chemical weapons were unambiguously banned as weapons of war by international agreement in 1925, a mere decade after their introduction on the battlefield. If we compare the three major anti-civilian weapons of the interwar period, air power, gas warfare, and economic blockade, it becomes clear that blockade was by far the deadliest. In World War I, 300,000 to 400,000 people died of blockade-induced starvation and illness in Central Europe, with an additional 500,000 deaths in the Ottoman provinces of the Middle East, affected by the Anglo-French blockade. Before World War II, these hundreds of thousands of deaths by economic isolation were the chief man-made cause of civilian death in 20th century conflict. Yet, unlike aerial bombing and gas warfare, the lethal effects of blockade were remarkably difficult to render visible and condemn, even to their direct users. Arnold Forster worried that the economic weapon is one which is so infernally convenient to use that it naturally commends itself to those who sit in offices. Pens seem so much cleaner instruments than bayonets and can be handled by the amateur with so much less exertion, so much less realization of the consequences. Sanctions were attractive not just because of their potential power, but also because they were easy to use for their handlers. Their coercive power was administered not out of the cockpit of a bomber or through the breech of a cannon, but from behind a mahogany desk. Sanctions, an American commentator argued, were special because their field of operations is not a visible terrain, but a force is exerted just the same. Precisely because sanctions combined concrete and ineffable qualities, they raised the question of how they changed the behaviour of those exposed to them. Wilson warned that a boycott could cripple a modern trading nation's standard of living, but he ultimately pinned his hopes not only on the physical pinch, not only the fact that you cannot get raw materials and must stop your factories, not only the fact that you cannot get credit, that your assets are useless, but on the mental force of being placed under sanctions, the still greater pinch that comes when a nation knows that it is sent to Coventry and is despised. Ignoring their physical effects, Wilson claimed their true power was psychological. Sanctions worked because it is the soul that is wounded much more poignantly than the body. Sanctions were a useful antidote to war exactly because in the modern world, being quarantined from global commerce was an unbearable form of imprisonment. Rather than restoring the liberal certainties of the pre-war world, the introduction of sanctions in 1919 meant that the post-World War I international order bore the permanent imprint of economic warfare. This involved a sustained effort to make economic pressure against civilians both technically legal and politically legitimate. International law had long been a paradigm for thinking about the use of force and questions of war and peace, but domestic legal institutions were affected too. States acquired new powers of control over private economic interests. Despite the internal logic of legal principles, during the rise of sanctions, the law functioned less as a constraint on politics than as a field of contestation in its own right. In this domain, disputes over the boundaries of regulation, emergency powers, economic coercion, and the use of force were central. Changes in international and domestic law had serious political, even strategic, consequences. As became clear during World War I, the hermetic encirclement of a modern trading state required controlling what its nationals did everywhere in the world. Effective isolation also depended on the power to stop third countries from trading with the enemy state. This desire to make economic sieges impregnable clashed with two older internationalist principles: freedom of the seas and legal neutrality. Sanctionists therefore began to redefine international law to restrict free navigation as well as neutral trading rights. Every state, company and individual had to join in isolating the aggressor. This changed the status of private trade, foreign investment and capital flows in the world economy. International firms, merchants, bankers and investors grew wary of peacetime sanctions as they struggled to reconstruct and protect their global networks in the wake of the war. They desired a legal and economic order that was free from political interference and protected their businesses and assets from the risk of interruption, devaluation or seizure. The history of sanctions is a prime example of how legal institutions shaped material outcomes and affected the tissue of globalization and the everyday lives of civilians. Law was no mere abstraction or scrap of paper, but a core domain for the elaboration of statecraft and strategy. Aside from new legal justifications, putting sanctions into effect prompted policymakers to engage in novel technical interventions. This book examines how interwar sanctionists developed mechanisms for energy control, blacklisting, import and export rationing, property seizures and asset freezes, trade prohibitions and preclusive purchasing, as well as financial blockade, the precursor to modern financial sanctions. The complexity of these techniques makes clear how much economic warfare depended on intelligence gathering and knowledge production. To cut off an entire country from the dense linkages that sustained global exchange, it was necessary to map the worldwide fabric of material flows connecting it to the rest of the world. But in the 1920s, the administrative state in many European countries was still in its infancy. The progress of sanctions came to depend not just on new legal powers, but also on more accurate statistics. In combining the quest for power with the elaboration of knowledge, sanctions were a quintessential form of so-called biopolitics, the state management of human lives and livelihoods, under conditions of advancing globalization. Sanctions also raise great questions about Europe's relationship to the wider world. For all the lofty talk about ending war among the great powers, in times of diplomatic crisis, it became clear that they were often aimed at smaller states. French cabinet minister Étienne Clémentel opined in 1917 that by controlling and withholding raw materials, the United States of Europe, of America, of Asia could find the sanction vainly sought in the force of arms which would impose peace on unruly peoples as on predatory peoples. Despite their supposed universality, League sanctions were considered suitable for use mainly against peripheral European states and semi-civilized countries. Justifying the infliction of pain from a distance came easily to European elites accustomed to managing colonial empires overseas and defending class rule at home. In 1919, the Soviet republics of Russia and Hungary were the first states to be subjected to Western blockades without an official declaration of war. In subsequent years, two border conflicts in the Balkans were diffused with threats of economic sanctions. Yugoslavia was made to desist in its invasion of Albania in 1921, while the Greek dictator Theodoros Pangalos was dissuaded from starting war with Bulgaria in 1925. In the years that followed, Turkey, China, and Japan each appeared in the crosshairs of the economic weapon. As global imperial powers, Britain and France were prepared to go much further in pressuring Asian peoples than fellow Europeans. Only in the 1930s did European challengers, such as Italy and Germany, come into view. Sanctionists originally conceived the economic weapon as a tool for keeping the peace within Europe. Many believed that if the ability to use sanctions had existed in July 1914, it could have held back Austria-Hungary and Serbia from dragging the continent into war. But the fact that post-World War I sanctions were usually considered against the periphery made them appear less a new peacekeeping practice than the latest disciplinary mechanism of Western empire. The limited enthusiasm for sanctions in the rest of the world meant that their operation was extraordinarily sensitive to continued agreement among the core League states. It was this uneasy combination of expansive material potential and constrained political legitimacy, a form of dominance without hegemony, that began to cause problems in the 1930s. Collective security, as the League's system of mutually supporting sanctions and aid became known, envisioned a world in which the sovereignty of each state was equally inviolable. But this was difficult to reconcile with the imperial and hierarchical order of the 30s. The rise of sanctions was thus bound up with the wider transformation of war, liberalism, law, and empire in the interwar years. As a result, sanctions played an important role in the crisis of globalization that erupted in the 1930s. The breakdown of the post-World War I order had many causes: waning enthusiasm for democracy, the popularity of revolutionary communism and rising fascism, the shock of the Great Depression, and the failure of disarmament efforts. Given these headwinds, it is hardly surprising that stability was shattered and the world slid toward a new global conflict. But this familiar story takes on a new quality when we integrate the history of sanctions into it. Interwar sanctions differed in their effects as the global situation changed. During the 1920s, war fatigue, reconstruction, and a return to growth allowed the economic weapon to play a stabilizing role. But amid the deteriorating circumstances of the 1930s, its effects became destabilizing. Examining how these structural shifts shaped the effect of sanctions forces us to reconsider what was fragile about the interwar order. Conceived during an era of high globalization, sanctions politicized the post-World War I world economy in new ways, creating fault lines that began to crack when conditions took a turn for the worse after the Depression. During the 1930s, many countries reacted to the deteriorating economic environment by launching programs of internal self-strengthening and autarky. Rather than stopping this nationalist tide and the risk of war that it entailed, sanctions reinforced it. Although this counterproductive effect was widely recognized at the time, it has not been systematically examined by historians. In doing so, this book outlines a new perspective on the interwar crisis of globalization. One of the dominant interpretations of the interwar crisis centers on the role of hegemonic stability. In this view, The early 20th century world was caught in a transition between hegemons. On the one hand, the fading imperial power of Britain, and on the other, an ascendant but immature United States, which shirked responsibility for a leadership role commensurate to its economic size. The danger of this interregnum became apparent during the Great Depression, when the international economic order entered a deep crisis marked by nationalism and disintegration. Hegemony theorists emphasised that it was only in the wake of World War II that the United States came to provide a stable international monetary and financial system, the Bretton Woods system, enabling an embedded liberalism of national welfare states. But in the 1930s, they argue there was not yet a great power available to provide the global public goods needed to save liberalism. That the interwar world was riven by profound tensions has also been the point of departure for historians, who emphasise competitive dynamics as a cause of breakdown. This realist-materialist vein of analysis has focused on the escalation propelled by uneven economic growth and industrial development, on the one hand, and military rivalry and ideological struggle on the other. The Depression opened a window for nationalist revival that was seized by states fearful of the dominant liberal capitalist powers. Instead of unity under a benevolent US umbrella, autonomy projects in the 1930s envisioned autarkic regional spheres of influence ruled by heavily armed empires. The historians in this group tend to regard international organisations such as the League as a well-intentioned sideshow to the central tragedy of full-spectrum power politics. The story of how a hegemonic vacuum and ideological economic rivalry produced spiralling insecurity is important, but it needs to be integrated with the research of historians of interwar internationalism in the last decade. These scholars have recovered the ambitious scope of early 20th century efforts in global governance, from refugee settlement and public health to drug prohibition, colonial supervision, and financial advising. In emphasising economic sanctions as another signal innovation of interwar internationalism, this book follows in the tracks of this growing literature. However, it shifts our attention back to the realm of international security. Charting the development of sanctions demands that we take seriously a capacity that hegemonists, competitive realists, and historians of interwar internationalism all consider to have been lacking in the League: coercive force. For this is what the economic weapon ultimately was. In its style and self-presentation, the League may have been opposed to power politics, but there was a remarkable continuity between the coalition that had starved Central Europe into defeating World War I and the elite policymakers who flocked to Geneva after the conflict. Indeed, personnel was policy. The blockaders of the Great War were the internationalists of the 1920s and inspired the sanctionists of the 1930s. Memories of blockade loomed very large in the imagination of interwar Europeans, and its renewed use against peacebreakers represented a daunting threat to small nations. As early as 1920, the head of the League's information section, the American journalist Arthur Sweetser, declared that if it is charged that the League is powerless because of lack of actual military or naval forces, it may easily be retorted that it possesses against a covenant-breaking state a force far more subtle and more powerful, the force of economic strangulation. The internationalists in Geneva, as well as those in London, Paris, Moscow, and Washington, did not shy away from the threat and use of massive economic force. To be sure, practical and strategic questions dogged the actual implementation of sanctions, but fear of economic isolation was more powerful than the League's ability to deploy it quickly. Wartime experience and internationalist discourse combined to give the economic weapon an ideological force far beyond its material readiness. Economic blockade acquired, in the words of the French jurist René Cassin, a permanent potentiality, une virtualité permanente. Interwar Europe was haunted by this spectre of sanctions. Whereas the threat of sanctions sufficed to restrain smaller states, it backfired against authoritarian states powerful enough to consider challenging the League. Deterrence broke down when fascist Italy risked confrontation by invading Ethiopia in 1935. Internationalist enforcement swung into action to implement Article 16 of the League Covenant. For the first time, economic sanctions were deployed at scale as three-quarters of the world's states severed most of their commercial links with Italy. The sanctions failed to hurt Benito Mussolini's regime quickly enough to save Ethiopia from conquest and occupation. Italy had prepared to withstand shortages. Nevertheless, Mussolini had to launch a campaign for comprehensive anti-sanctions autarky, autarkia, to survive financial attrition. Sanctions so depleted Italian economic strength that Il Duce could not consider another offensive war for several years. The Italo-Ethiopian War is often interpreted as a defeat for internationalism at the hands of fascism and imperialism. But from a strategic material perspective, it is better seen as the moment when the first major use of economic pressure dramatically raised the stakes of using sanctions as a tool to maintain world order. The League sanctions were seriously worrying to other revisionist states. Officials in Nazi Germany became convinced they would be the next target. In early 1936, a regime-wide drive began to achieve blockade resilience under the four-year plan. Japan, too, started to worry about its prospects for regional autonomy. To both Berlin and Tokyo, territorial expansion became a way to enhance self-reliance, mobilize popular support, and retain strategic independence. Conquest appeared as an avenue of escape from the anxiety of living under the Damoclean sword of international blockade. Over time, the seeming inevitability of economic war prompted both Adolf Hitler and the Japanese leadership to secure resources by any means available. The internationalist search for more effective sanctions and the ultra-nationalist search for autarky thereby became locked in an escalatory spiral. Of course, the economic weapon was only one among several causes of the outbreak of World War II. Its threat interacted with existing aggressive impulses and other influences. But while historians have given plenty of attention to conventional military factors, as well as the ideological, political, economic, and social origins of war, the role of sanctions in shaping the aggression of fascist and militarist powers in the late 1930s has not been sufficiently examined. That sanctions played an unintentional destabilizing role in the interwar collapse is all the more tragic since the League's Article 16 entailed more than prohibitive measures alone. During the Great War, the phrase economic weapon also denoted a positive agenda to provide other societies with material resources rather than depriving them. Between 1916 and 1920, this logistical function was fulfilled by inter-allied organisations such as the Allied Maritime Transport Council, AMTC, and the Supreme Economic Council, SEC, which simultaneously mobilised resources for the Entente through the same world markets from which they were severing the Central Powers. The provision of supplies to allies was indissolubly linked with the interdiction of supplies to the enemy. These policies, diametrically opposed in their effects, were two sides of the same economic weapon. John Maynard Keynes, one of the architects of inter-allied war finance and a famous critic of economic punishment, saw great promise in these positive tools as early as 1924. But despite interest from certain British internationalists and financiers, in the interwar years, France was the only major state to consistently support a permanent mechanism to provide emergency financing to the victims of aggressive war. If small nations could rely on the material backing of a broad alliance in case they were attacked, such a guarantee would itself function as a deterrent to potential aggressors. This economic plan to prevent aggression produced the Convention on Financial Assistance in 1930, an internationalist initiative that has been all but forgotten. But due to political disagreements and fiscal conservatism, the convention never went into force. The result was that the League talked up the threat of blockade against aggressors without putting in place an aid mechanism for their victims, a highly unstable combination that was easily breached. The fragility of international institutions stemmed from this imbalance of focus, which prioritised discipline and punishment in the form of austerity at home and sanctions abroad, while neglecting expansion and solidarity, both in domestic warfare and in foreign aid. As World War II erupted, the wisdom of the positive economic weapon was appreciated anew. The Roosevelt administration began to direct financial assistance to Latin America and China in 1938 to 1939 to counter German and Japanese influence. But the idea that solidarity with the beleaguered was just as important as the punishment of aggressors found its most consummate expression in the global provision programme of Lend-Lease, begun in early 1941. Centred on the United States, both sanctions and supply thus survived the interwar years to be reincorporated into the United Nations organisation when it was founded in 1945. The history of this positive economic weapon grew out of early 20th century war economics. Yet as the negative instrument of sanctions has come to dominate modern geopolitics, the shared origins and complementary function of these two approaches has been overlooked. The interwar history of sanctions is instructive for our 21st century world in another way as well. Sanctions exploited the economic networks of interwar globalization, but ultimately undermined its political foundations. Today, as the world economy reels from financial crises, nationalism, trade wars, and a global pandemic, sanctions are aggravating existing tensions within globalization. That sanctions are intended to promote international stability is, unfortunately, no defense against this risk. Unintended negative consequences can be just as destructive as premeditated harms. Interwar history should sharpen our sense of what the stabilizing power of provision could have done if it had not been overshadowed by the destabilizing effects of deprivation, real and imagined. For as long as humans have organized themselves politically, they have used material channels to persuade, cajole, and coerce each other. Sanctions are often traced back to Thucydides' account of rival city-states in ancient Greece. In his Peloponnesian War, he records Athens's commercial ban against merchants from the Greek port city of Megara in 432 BC, an event that international relations scholars have proclaimed the first case of economic sanctions in history. But besides scholarly disagreement over the exact nature of the Megaran decree, such claims about ancient origins construct misleading continuities across space and time. A purely state-centred definition excessively widens the definition of sanctions to any economic policy with a political aim without considering how these practices function, both materially and morally, in the international system in which they are deployed. Two distinguishing characteristics of modern economic sanctions are their link with the enforcement of norms and the international legal and economic imagination behind them. For much of medieval and early modern history, the word sanction, derived from the Latin verb sancire, meaning to ratify or to underwrite, connotated approval. In the medieval church and at the courts of Catholic monarchs, for example, it was common to use pragmatic sanctions to endorse special cases of royal inheritance by female heirs. But the term started to acquire another, slightly different meaning in the late 19th century. As the world grew economically integrated to an unprecedented degree, the question of what principles underpinned this international order became more pressing. This is when the term sanction acquired its second meaning of guarantee or enforcement. Because the 19th century international system was ruled hierarchically by a group of great powers and governed by European principles of law, their sanctions were conceived of as punitive measures to uphold civilization against barbarism. In its scale and nature, this order was totally different from the Aegean world inhabited by ancient Athenians. The modern meaning of economic sanctions, that is, to use material exclusion from the world economy to protect international norms, was unimaginable before the economic and cultural conditions created by globalization beginning in the mid-19th century. While economic pressure is an age-old weapon, economic sanctions to enforce visions of international order are a distinctly modern innovation. This narrower definition of sanctions helps to distinguish them from related but distinct tools of policy regarding trade, industry, development, technology, and aid. Tariffs, for example, are often referred to as trade sanctions, but they differ in crucial ways from the economic sanctions whose history is traced in this study. Customs tariffs are forms of legislation that shield a given economy or domestic industry from competition. Economic sanctions, by contrast, are offensive in nature. Although some of their aspects can be enforced through domestic legislation, their object is located beyond the borders of the states using them. It is one or more other national economies that are placed under sanctions. Tariffs function like taxes. They make exchange more expensive and difficult, but do not prevent it categorically. Sanctions, on the other hand, prevent all entry or exit of a given commodity, and in this they reflect the blockade techniques that inspired them. The key difference is that sanctions are restrictions on exchange imposed on their target from the outside. They seek to exert force over other actors at a distance. What tariffs have in common with sanctions is that they are both located on a spectrum of prohibition. As practices of prohibition expanded during the early modern period, so did the vocabulary to describe them. The embargo, from the Spanish verb embargar, meaning to arrest, emerged during the 16th century as a royal order to seize enemy ships at anchor in Habsburg ports. But the degree to which European states enforced these restrictions differed significantly. It was not uncommon for merchants to maintain trade with countries at war with their own government. As Spain fought its rebellious Dutch provinces in the 80 Years' War, 1568 to 1648, Dutch traders continued to sell to Spanish territories, even when Spanish embargoes prevented them from buying anything in return. In their eyes, making money by trading with the enemy was no betrayal of the fight for independence, but a way to accumulate the wealth that sustained it. The logic of commerce, therefore, competed with the logic of war, and often won. In the mid-17th century, the term blockade entered most European languages as a term for besieging cities, islands, and territories. Two factors circumscribed the use of blockades. The first was that blockade was a belligerent act. It depended on the existence of a state of war. To exercise the rights of blockade, states had to formally declare war. Blockades were thus a form of combat, not a mere administrative matter. Jonathan Swift reported a British army officer in the 1720s insisting that the army is the only school for gentlemen. Damn me, I would be glad by God to see any of your scholars with his nouns and his verbs and his philosophy and trigonometry. What a figure he would make at a siege or blockade. So long as a state of war obtained, it was permissible to apply ruthless pressure against civilians. However, when a peace treaty was signed, the blockade had to be lifted and all trade freedoms restored. A second limitation to blockade was material. Economic war in the early modern period aimed primarily to degrade the income and resources of rival states. To starve citizens who in many places were self-reliant in food production was possible only in highly localized sieges of individual towns or small city-states. The relatively self-sufficient character of most larger agrarian states meant that their exposure to external pressure was limited. Cutting off trade in manufactures and colonial raw materials could inflict considerable damage, but most countries' trade dependence was not widespread or profound enough to enable wars to be won through material pressure alone. The limited reach of interdependence before the 19th century made early modern economic pressure qualitatively and quantitatively different from modern economic sanctions. But from the Napoleonic era onward, Britain began to exploit commercial channels in a more systematic way. At the Congress of Vienna in 1814 to 1815, Foreign Secretary Lord Castlereagh proposed to give weight to the conference's international declaration against the slave trade by organising a non-purchase campaign against goods made with slave labour. Spain, Portugal and France could thereby be forced to phase out the transatlantic slave trade. Although the proposal did not come to fruition, it demonstrated a growing awareness that trade restriction could be used for humanitarian objectives. On the whole, however, severing nations from worldwide exchange went against the grain of the greater freedom of flows that accompanied 19th century capitalist expansion. Historians now widely characterise the years between the 1840s and 1914 as the first great era of globalisation. What has been less recognised is that an important legal pillar of this process was the growing body of law that protected private property from interstate conflict. This separationist theory of war and commerce drew on strong currents of Enlightenment thinking. Jean-Jacques Rousseau's On the Social Contract, 1762, argued that war then is not a relationship between one man and another, but a relationship between one state and another. Any state can only have other states and not men as enemies. In the Napoleonic era, this view became the basis for the so-called Rousseau-Portalist doctrine, which held that individual civilians were not responsible for the actions of their governments. Private property in war was therefore inviolable by the state as a public entity. The doctrine quickly became dominant in national law, statecraft, and diplomacy across continental Europe. To modernize, 19th century wars protected commerce and finance to a degree that is almost unbelievably generous. During the Crimean Wars between Britain and Russia, 1854 to 1856, Her Majesty's Treasury continued to fulfil its payment obligations to the Tsarist government on old loans. Meanwhile, Russia dutifully paid interest to owners of its sovereign debt living in Britain. A British government minister saw it as beyond dispute for civilised nations that public debts should be paid to an enemy during war. In the treaty ending that war, the Paris Declaration of 1856, the first multilateral treaty open to signature by any country, the maritime foundations of globalisation acquired a further layer of protection through the creation of a category of free goods that were immune to seizure on the high seas. But war on land enjoyed similar protections. As they led a revolt against rule from Vienna, Italian noblemen continued to draw regular income from their estates in Austrian-held Lombardy. After unification, Italy signed treaties with Austria-Hungary and the United States that rendered civilian property immune from seizure in conflict. Arch-militarist Prussia honoured these principles even as it fought a series of short, brutal wars to unify Germany in 1864 to 1871. Rare cases of politically motivated financial restrictions, such as Bismarck's 1887 loan ban, Lombard-Verbo, against Russia, proved the general rule that geopolitics and market regulation usually remained separate. The Russian government promoted the inviolability of private property on land by belligerents, a principle that was generalised in the Second Hague Treaty of 1907. Both old and new European elites could support the separation of war from commerce. To aristocrats, purely military wars satisfied the demands of honour while preserving their landed wealth, whereas the bourgeoisie could learn to live with periodic armed conflict if property and contract retained their integrity. The economic thinker Karl Polanyi described this 19th century arrangement as one that guarded with extreme rigour against a general war while providing for peaceful business amid an endless sequence of minor ones. By erecting a barrier between public war and private economic life, laissez-faire liberalism made economic sanctions as a state policy affecting all of economy and society nearly impossible. Over the course of the 19th century, two developments began to put this segregated system of war and commerce under pressure. The first was Europe's growing imperialism, which routinely broke down its central barrier by waging war on the livelihood of entire peoples outside the civilised world. One manifestation of this was the rise of Pacific blockade, the 19th century practice that most resembled 20th century sanctions. As their commercial influence on other continents grew, Britain and France began to exploit the considerable grey area between formal peace and open war. The first time that they imposed a blockade without declaring war was to help Greek insurgents revolting against the Ottoman Empire in the 1820s. In the following decades, these brief episodes of maritime pressure were increasingly accompanied by more aggressive actions, such as raids and naval bombardments. Common reasons for doing so were debt repayment and the protection of European citizens and property abroad. Between 1827 and 1913, imperial powers used Pacific blockade to bend weaker states to their will at least 23 times. This form of economic pressure, short of war, took advantage of the discrepancy in power between European empires and smaller states in Latin America, Mediterranean Europe, the Balkans, and Southeast Asia. While the measure was, in the words of one British diplomat, contemplating how to make Venezuela repay its debts, totally inapplicable in the case of a great power, it was nonetheless suitable to the case of a recalcitrant petty state in controversy with great powers of overwhelming strength, who, while desiring to obtain proper redress, are unwilling to dismember or destroy a puny antagonist. European imperialists never had a monopoly on the use of economic pressure, however. In fact, the state-centred tradition of embargoes and blockades, from which sanctions would emerge, had a civil society counterpart. This was the organisation of economic non-interaction by political and social movements against foreign oppressors or moral injustices. American colonists and British Quakers had used such tactics in the 18th century. Organised non-intercourse as a global phenomenon therefore existed before it had a proper name, the boycott. The term originated in a famous case in 1880, in which the Irish Land League, which fought for the rights of landless peasants, used a policy of non-interaction to pressure Charles Boycott, the despotic agent of an absentee landlord, into making concessions to rural tenants. Soon his name was widely used as a noun and verb. It entered the French language 1 year later, and by the end of the decade was used in Spanish, Italian, Portuguese, Swedish, German, Dutch, and even several Asian languages. The rapid proliferation of the term itself in the 1880s shows that boycotts were directly linked to the globalisation of trade and information in the late 19th century. As steamships and telegraph networks allowed faster travel and communication and the circulation of print media exploded, groups from the Chinese Boxer rebels to the Indian Swadeshi movement and Polish nationalists used these technologies to organise campaigns of private economic pressure. The second trend that undermined the separation of commerce and war was growing internal opposition among European elites. British common law justices had never liked the Enlightenment separationist theory. As one judge, John Nicol, argued in 1800, there cannot exist, at the same time, a war of arms and a peace of commerce. On this view, a state of war suspended the foundations of private economic life and allowed the seizure and suspension of all enemy property and contracts. British conservatives and navalists wanted to give the Royal Navy free rein to interdict global commerce. They chafed at restrictions imposed by international law, whose separationist rules they secretly planned to repudiate in case of war. In France, a new generation of naval thinkers, the Jean École, saw the revolutionary upheaval of the Paris Commune as evidence that wars could be won by triggering social unrest on the enemy's home front. They argued for an all-out offensive against commercial supply lines, as well as artillery bombardment of civilian population centres. This orientation was consonant with strategic thinking in the United States, which had won the Civil War against the Confederacy by waging total war on land and mounting a naval blockade of southern cotton exports. American elites thus agreed with British and French navalists that in an age of industrialism and globalisation, civil society was a legitimate target of war. Alfred Thayer Mahon, the American naval theorist who was the most widely read military thinker of the late 19th century world, argued that property engaged in commerce was the lifeblood of national prosperity, and as such, it is national in its employment and only in ownership private. To stop such circulation is to sap national prosperity, and to sap prosperity, upon which war depends for its energy, is a measure as truly military as is killing the men whose arms maintain war in the field. These fin-de-siècle visions of open war against civilian economies were bleak, but in some ways these anti-separationists were merely thinking the material realities of a globalised world through to their logical conclusions. It was precisely the laissez-faire ideal of an apolitical international economy totally insulated from war that was historically novel. This project displayed a distinctively 19th century faith in the progress of trade and law as hallmarks of Western civilization. Separationism was embraced by liberal politicians in Great Britain, but also by German bureaucrats, Belgian and French international lawyers, Italian aristocrats and Russian generals, as well as bourgeois merchants from Bremen to Bombay to Buenos Aires. As a result, by the beginning of the 20th century, it seemed to many that the arteries of global trade and finance were a vital force holding back the possibility of a large-scale conflict. Economic sanctions were only an elusive hope, one of many utopian schemes populating the newspapers, cafes, and lecture halls of the period. The sanctionist idea became popular in the international arbitration movement, a loose group of jurists in Europe and the United States who wanted to end the occurrence of war by submitting all interstate disputes to a neutral arbiter, ideally a world court. But to be effective, This arbiter had to possess some sanction or guarantee its judgments were respected by non-compliant states. Under domestic law, states had a variety of punishments for lawbreakers, but in international politics, it was much less clear how one could punish an entire state. In 1906, a group of French arbitrationists proposed sanctions with an economic content. Boycotts and the temporary freezing, sequestration of foreign property were put forward as options. The lawyer Jacques Dumas argued that the sanction of bills would be more efficacious than the sanction of bullets. More aggressive options, such as intervention by international naval and land forces, were controversial. These were clearly a form of war, not a way to stop it. If arbitration leads to war, another jurist objected, the question of pacification will not have advanced at all. The possibility of exploiting economic interdependence to uphold law and preserve peace was thus being considered in arbitrationist circles. The first attempt to generalise this insight came from the eccentric merchant-turned-internationalist Léon Bollack. A Frenchman who had created his own universal language, launched a gold coin as international currency, and proposed to unite Britain and France in a confederation called Westia, or Westie, Bollack put forward another idea in 1911, a global law of customs boycott. Under this law, if a country refused to respect an arbitration verdict, all other arbitrationist states could punish it by refusing entry to its goods, expropriating its foreign property, and blocking its financial transfers. In September 1912, Bollack presented this idea to the Universal Peace Congress in Geneva. Its goal was straightforward: tuer la guerre, to kill war. Bollack's idea attracted immediate criticism from other arbitrationists who saw the world economy with its division of labour as a complex organism to be protected. One of them, the Hungarian sociologist André de Mede, warned that it was dangerous to envision the complete isolation of a people, and especially the interruption of international communication. Was it wise, he asked, to inflict a crying injustice, such as preventing food imports on a civilian population, saving it from war only to subject it to famine instead? Dumas agreed, proclaiming that the boycott was an institution of the past, and that modern morality regarded it as an injustice to penalise individuals for the faults and missteps of governments. The arbitrationist debate about economic sanctions was a theoretical discussion of a tool that, at the time, existed only on paper. Mede and Dumas had delivered prudential critiques of economic sanctions, the first but certainly not the last such warnings in history. By contrast, Bollack's utopianism appeared wildly out of touch with growing geopolitical tensions around the world. Arbitrationism proved too weak politically to prevent European governments from embarking on war in July 1914. Yet in an unexpected twist, the war ended up making one of the movement's ideas a reality. The total war advocates in most European states gained the upper hand over the proponents of continuing business as usual. Property was seized, shipping lanes were blockaded, bank accounts were frozen, and private firms were placed under close surveillance. The world economy was subjected to the ruthless logic of strategic victory using all means available. But after 4 years of grinding global conflict, the victors did, in fact, create an international mechanism to protect peace with economic sanctions. The answer to the arbitrationist puzzle, how to make international law binding, emerged from the way that the Entente waged a new kind of industrial, commercial, and financial warfare. Economic sanctions arose when the conditions of advanced globalization encountered the techniques of total war. How this sudden shift changed the world is the story told in this book. The economic weapon is composed of three parts, each of which examines a consecutive phase in the history of sanctions and adopts a distinct focus to do so. Part 1, The Origins of the Economic Weapon, covers the blockade project pursued by Britain and France from 1914, spanning the Great War and the immediate post-war years up to the restoration of trade with Bolshevik Russia in 1921. Chapter 1 charts how the evolving wartime politics of blockade presented new challenges and opportunities for intervention in a deeply interdependent world economy, from the management of neutral trade to the interdiction of finance. Chapter 2 examines how the economic weapon took shape between 1917 and the drafting of the League's Article 16 sanctions procedure at the Paris Peace Conference in early 1919. It was in this period that blockade administration changed from an instrument of state policy to a technocratic internationalism, rendered more effective after US entry into the conflict on the Allied side. This chapter shows how this globe-spanning control over raw materials inspired the idea of using international resource boycotts after the war. It also documents how the Versailles negotiations among Woodrow Wilson, Robert Cecil, and Léon Bourgeois unintentionally produced a League of Nations that could apply blockade-style sanctions without declaring war on aggressor states. Chapter 3 studies the first peacetime use of economic pressure by the Allies in 1919 as they blockaded revolutionary communist regimes in Russia and Hungary. This episode launched a public debate across Europe about the ethics of economic war on civilians. Vocal campaigns by feminist, humanitarian, leftist and liberal groups eventually helped persuade the Allies to moderate economic pressure on Central and Eastern Europe, for fear of driving populations into the hands of political radicals instead of toward bourgeois stability. Part 2, The Legitimacy of the Economic Weapon, is an institutional history of how national elites and the technocrats in the League managed the powerful but incomplete system that took shape during the 1920s. Beginning with the League's convening of an international blockade committee in 1921 and ending with the international crisis over Manchuria in 1931, Chapters 4 and 5 trace how the option of economic sanctions appeared in virtually every international crisis of this period. There was a profoundly imperial dimension to the way the economic weapon operated in this period. Threats of economic sanctions successfully restrained border wars in the Balkans, convinced Turkey to give up territorial claims in Iraq, and were continuously considered against striking workers and anti-colonial nationalist resistance in China. Chapter 6 shows how the struggle to secure wider legitimacy for sanctions against civil society and private economic interests led to a deep but underappreciated political rift within Western liberal elites. This split between sanctionists and neutralists weakened the imperial internationalist consensus on which the League rested and complicated its relations with external powers, especially the United States. Part 3, Economic Sanctions in the Interwar Crisis, assesses the role of the economic weapon in the global crisis of the 1930s and 1940s, from the Great Depression until the end of World War II. Chapter 7 investigates the difficulties of implementing sanctions from Manchuria to South America and the fraught efforts to deter a set of powerful challenges to the post-World War I order from Japan, Nazi Germany, and Fascist Italy. Chapter 8 reconsiders the most famous interwar use of the economic weapon, the League sanctions against Mussolini's regime during the Italo-Ethiopian War, arguing that this crisis produced a new understanding of sanctions focused on attrition. But why did sanctions not prevent the return of conflict and the eventual outbreak of another world war? Answering this question requires us to look beyond narratives of the 1930s as an ideological struggle between liberalism and totalitarianism, or democracies and dictatorships. Instead, the analysis presented here advances a more hard-nosed view of how economic pressure spurred competition for raw materials, financial reserves, and territory. Chapter 9 suggests that the intensification of autarky in the mid-1930s can be understood as driven in part by a general blockade phobia, brought on by memories of economic war and kept alive by sanctions. Chapter 10 provides a materialist interpretation of World War II as a conflict revolving around the construction of coalitions for resource control. When, after 1941, Anglo-French economic warfare was supplemented by the US Lend-Lease program, unifying coercion and aid into a single constellation, the sanctionists belatedly attained the collective security that had eluded them in the 1930s. The book concludes by examining how the legacy of the interwar economic weapon shaped the post-1945 international order and what this history means for our 21st century present, as the widespread use of sanctions today raises new questions about the politics of globalization. Part 1. The Origins of the Economic Weapon. Chapter 1. The Machinery of Blockade, 1914 to 1917. At the end of August 1914, 3 weeks into the war, the German diplomat Kurt Rietzler wrote a letter to his fiancée, Katja Liebermann. Trained as a classicist in Munich, Rietzler had already spent several years as personal political adviser to the head of government, Chancellor Theobald von Bethmann-Hollweg. At age 32, he embodied the peremptory confidence of Wilhelmina Germany's ruling elite. From his post at the Imperial Army headquarters, he reassured Katja that everything is going well, the question of provision is also being taken care of, and we will not starve. The English will certainly hold on to the bitter end like they did against Napoleon I, but we will set up a continental system in a more refined way than Napoleon. Rietzler's invocation of Napoleonic history was understandable. In August 1914, it seemed that European history was repeating an older pattern. Once more, Britain faced a powerful land empire aiming for continental dominance, and again, it used its maritime power to restrict its terrestrial opponent's access to world trade, forcing the opponent, then France, now Germany, to create a self-sufficient European economic bloc. But beyond these similarities, the comparison obscured more than it illuminated. In material terms, the world in which Rietzler lived was not at all like that of the 1800s. The intervening century had seen an unprecedented expansion of trade, integration of markets, rise in industrial production, urbanization of society, and democratization of institutions. As a result, when the Triple Entente of Britain, France, and Russia embarked on economic war against the Central Powers, Germany and Austria-Hungary, joined a few months later by the Ottoman Empire and Bulgaria, it did so under conditions vastly different from those of the Napoleonic era. Severing its continental enemies from external markets led the Entente to develop a system of economic surveillance and control without historical precedent. What resulted was a transnational enterprise to master something far larger than a single rival empire: the global trading system. The experience of managing this apparatus from 1914 to 1918 convinced Allied policymakers that economic pressure was a force so powerful that it could prevent future wars. But how did this policy develop to the point that it acquired such war-stopping allure? The administrative history of the blockade is well known, yet how the wartime blockade shaped the economic weapon that emerged at the Paris Peace Conference has been much less examined. In the process of learning how to wage economic war, British and French officials and their allies began to exploit interdependence. To do this, they intervened in the infrastructure of the world economy. This involved gathering intelligence, producing qualitative and quantitative knowledge, and devising policy instruments with which to enforce the isolation of their enemies. Although building the economic weapon required vast reservoirs of knowledge, how to use this information remained an inescapably political choice. Rival institutions, individuals, and interests therefore clashed in the management of economic warfare. But it was precisely this flexibility in using its levers for political ends that, over time, strengthened the appeal of blockade as a model for future sanctions. The blockade became one of the most consequential experiments in global economic governance of the 20th century. Building their economic weapon in a thoroughly interconnected world launched the Allied blockaders on a voyage of discovery. There is no better way to illustrate this process than to delve deeply into the blockade enterprise itself. This chapter provides an overview of the development of the Allied blockade, but focuses on two particularly illuminating learning experiences: the control of raw materials and the emergence of financial blockade. These policies became the wartime predecessors to later commodity embargoes and financial sanctions. A focus on minerals and money brings out how closely the material and financial dimensions of economic pressure were intertwined. Our journey therefore begins with a small but essential commodity in world trade in 1914, the mineral ore known as manganese. Manganese and globalization. Manganese is a chunky, silver-grey metal found in lumps and arteries in the Earth's crust. It has long been known to have the capacity to harden iron objects. In 19th century Central Europe, blacksmiths used small amounts of manganese when smelting pig iron in their furnaces to produce a tougher, shiny product called spiegelisen, mirror iron. What allowed it to become a key mineral was the revolution in modern steel manufacturing launched by the discovery of the Bessemer process in the 1850s. Tinkering in the hills of Gloucestershire, Henry Bessemer and Robert Mushet developed a method to produce steel that involved deoxidising molten pig iron by adding manganese to it, radically improving its quality and preventing rust and corrosion. Manganese thus became a preferred input for alloys used to manufacture strong yet relatively cheap stainless steel. By the 1890s, electric furnaces using high-grade manganese ore could turn out prime industrial metal. In the early 20th century, Germany was the second largest steelmaker in the world after the United States, accounting for half of all West European and almost a quarter of global production. Its steel industry was dominated by conglomerates such as Krupp, which manufactured everything from hulls, girders and beams to plating, pipes, track and helmets. But the raw materials that went into this prodigious output came largely from outside Germany. Iron ore arrived in trains from France and Luxembourg, and coal from the Ruhr region itself. Steadily improving supply lines meant that Krupp plants were fed by a continuous flow of inputs delivered throughout the year from all over the world. This allowed the firm to achieve an enormous yearly steel production while operating on very small inventories. In 1913, Krupp held stocks of raw materials that covered just 2 months of production. Despite its leading position in European steelmaking, German industry thus depended on overseas supply. Manganese, which had very few European mines, was a case in point. Most of the world's manganese came from the Chiatura mines in Georgia, then part of the Russian Empire. British India, which had deposits on the Malabar coast, provided the second largest supply. In 1913, combined output of Russian and Indian mines came to 2 million tonnes, some 90% of global production. The third and fourth largest producers were Brazil, which exported about 183,000 tonnes of manganese in 1913 and 1914, and Spain, which produced just 21,000 tonnes, less than 1% of global output. Commensurate with its share of global steel output, Germany consumed a quarter of the annual world production of manganese. All in all, this meant that over 500,000 tonnes of manganese ore arrived in Germany in 1912, nearly two-thirds from Russia, a quarter from India, 6% from Spain, and 4% from Brazil. The needs of German steel producers drove considerable manganese imports. Where the ore came from, however, was determined by a variety of factors. Transport infrastructure was one of these. The mid-19th century transportation revolution had dramatically lowered freight rates for oceanic transport. Despite major railway investment in recent decades, maritime transport often remained cheaper than overland supply. For a solid bulk good like manganese, even small distances by rail added significantly to the wholesale price. By the time Russian ore reached the Black Sea port of Poti, just 180 kilometres from the mining pit at Chiatura, its unit price had tripled from 10 to 30 francs per kilo due to the dire state of Tsarist railways in Georgia. German firms imported from Brazil because it was often cheaper to have mineral ores sent overseas from Latin America than to transport them overland from Russia. Krupp's main plants were located in the Ruhr Valley in western Germany, connecting them to world markets via the Rhine River through the Netherlands. In the 1880s and 1890s, a wave of European investment in Brazilian railroads further increased the ease of access and hence competitiveness of Latin American ores compared to those from Russia, which, as noted, relied on much poorer railways. Physical and political conditions of production also shaped supply. Indian manganese benefited from the low cost of colonial labour on the subcontinent. Although plentiful, the Russian manganese mines at Chiatura were a hotbed of revolutionary agitation. The young Georgian Yusuf Yugashvili, later known as Stalin, started his political career as a Bolshevik by organising mining workers in the region. Finally, the quality of the material mattered. Manganese-holding ores with higher concentrations of the pure chemical element were prized, since smaller amounts were then needed to produce a unit of steel. Brazilian mines held high-quality ores of 50% purity, whereas Russian deposits were cheaper but low grade. All these reasons, good infrastructure, political stability.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.